Harper Paperbacks and Harper Audio present The House of Yen, a family at the heart of a century in Chinese history. By Lan Yan. Translated from the French edition by Sam Taylor. Read by Angela Lin. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/audio/House of Yen. It contains a history of China and a family tree. Preface. On January 1st, 2016, I was in Sanya, on the tropical island of Hainan, in the south of China, to celebrate the New Year with my father. I told him I was thinking of writing about the history of the Yan family. Despite his 84 years and fragile health, my father leaped up and squeezed my hands with all his strength, as if he wanted to impart all the energy inside his body. "Not only is that an excellent idea," he told me, "but you should make it your priority for the coming year." I didn't say this to him, but his reaction reassured me in the decision I had made. During all the years I spent in France, whenever my French friends asked me about my family or the history of China, I could tell how astonished they were when I told them what we had lived through. They had very little conception of what had happened during the Cultural Revolution or the period that preceded it. One day, my closest friends, Catherine and Bertrand Julien Laferrière. Bertrand is my son's godfather, and I am the godmother of one of their Chinese daughters, encouraged me to tell the story of my family, which was, in microcosm, the history of modern China. That was 10 years ago, and their words have continued to echo within me, along with the famous adage that, for an accomplished life, one must plant a tree, have a child, write a book. My son is 20 now. How will he ever know his family's history if not through books? Biographies of my grandfather have already been published in China. My father completed his memoirs after 10 years of writing and research in Beijing and Moscow. My mother, too, wrote the history of her family for me. I am grateful to her for that, and I feel honor-bound to continue this tradition. What I have seen, heard, experienced, was so intense that I must take my turn to bear witness to it. Yan Lan. In China, my name is Yan Lan. The family name always appears before the given name in China, as you will notice throughout the book. Prologue. I was 4 months old when my parents entrusted me to the care of my paternal grandparents. Mama was about to leave for Rome before joining the Chinese embassy in Bern, where she was posted during 1 year. And with my father being a Russian interpreter for many high-placed Chinese dignitaries, among them the supreme leader Mao Zedong, he did not have time to look after me either. So it was that the faces of Nai Nai, my grandmother, and Ye Ye, my grandfather, along with the face of the Ayi, my nanny, became more familiar to me than those of my diplomat parents, more familiar and, if I am honest, more tender and kindly toward their little Nan Nan, their nickname for me, and considerably less severe than my mother's. In her memoirs, my mother writes that she left her baby at the State Council's residence in the center of Beijing, where my paternal grandparents had, for years, lived in a staff apartment on the third floor, right-hand door, of Building 10. That was the address where I lived, where I had my bedroom, where my grandfather's chauffeur took us when Ye Ye came to fetch me for the weekend from the entrance to the garden of the boarding school where I was placed at the age of 3. So it was unusual that day when my mother came to pick me up from a primary school. To be enrolled there, I had to pass an exam, and on the solemn occasion of my application to join the first grade class of this prestigious establishment, my mother had made herself available, eager as she was to find out how her daughter had fared in that oral exam. I have good reasons to remember that day. The test, as my mother called it, was this. I was shown the picture of a cat climbing the trunk of a tree where a small bird was perched on a branch. The teacher asked me to tell her what I thought would happen next.
"And what did you say?"
my mother asked me. I explained that the cat was climbing up to the bird so he could become its friend.
"That's completely wrong," my mother replied, instantly irritated. "What you should have said is that the cat was about to eat the bird."
Needless to say, I was not accepted. That was the first and the last time that I failed an exam. It was summer 1964. I was 7 years old. 1. A revolution is not a dinner party, or writing an essay, or painting a picture, or doing embroidery. It cannot be so refined, so leisurely and gentle, so temperate, kind, courteous, restrained, and magnanimous. A revolution is an insurrection, an act of violence by which one class overthrows another. Mao Zedong, The Little Red Book, 1966. There are 7 or 8 of them. 7 or 8 men, heels hammering up the 3 flights of stairs in apartment building 10 of the state council's residence. Their fists pound on the door. 7 or 8 caps, uniforms, armbands rush into the apartment.
"Yan Baohang,"
the caps bark. This is not the name of the woman in the kitchen, our Ayi, who is making dinner and who cries out in fear. It is not the name of my grandmother. I shove my face into her soft fleece blouse, and her hands cover my ears to protect them from the shouting. Yan Baohang, the name they are barking all over our apartment, is my grandfather's name, the name of the man I call Ye Ye. I am crying because I am not used to all this yelling, all these staircase stampedes, all this banging on doors. Despite my grandmother's hands, which tremble as they stroke my hair, despite the downy warmth of her blouse, where I have cocooned my fear, the barking of those 7 or 8 tense jaws terrifies me.
Yan Baohang,
my grandfather's name. Yan Baohang does not hide. He has come out of his office. He stands there calmly.
"Yes, that's me. Who are you? What do you want?"
One of the caps turns to me then and says,
"No need to cry, little girl. He's just coming with us so we can talk. It's very simple."
The cap adds,
"He will come with us for a few hours, or a few days, to talk with us. And when he has said everything he has to say, your grandfather will come home. So there's nothing to cry about."
My grandfather does not say,
"That's right. None, none. Don't be scared."
My grandfather, Yan Baohang, who does not look angry or upset, have I ever seen Ye Ye angry or upset, who does not even seem worried, merely serious, replies in the cool, composed voice that he always uses in solemn moments.
"In that case, gentlemen, in order for me to comply with your request, namely, that I follow you so that we can talk, I must see some official papers, an arrest warrant, something that proves..."
Papers? But how could a few pieces of paper prevent my grandfather from eating dinner with us, as he does every evening? How could a few pieces of paper deprive me of my grandfather's palm placed ritually on my head as he says in his gentle, tender voice,
"Come on, Nun Nun. It's time for bed now."
But as I peek sideways from my grandmother's blouse, just to check that such papers do not exist,
I see them being taken from the pocket of a uniform jacket and held in front of my grandfather's face. With one hand, he adjusts his glasses. With the other, he signals the men to go through into his office, and he says,
"The only radio in the apartment is in there. Please, gentlemen, examine it to ensure that it is not, as you claim, a telegraph transceiver. You are still suspicious? Very well, gentlemen. Then please take this radio. Have it examined. Let us be done with this."
40 minutes passed. The three of us did not move, did not speak. The IE stood in the kitchen doorway, while Nai Nai and I sat in the dining room. Other than the pounding of my grandmother's heart, which I could feel through the fabric of her blouse, other than my grandfather's dry cough, reaching us from his office where he was locked in with those soldiers, not a single sound was audible in the dark apartment building. The night held its breath. Suddenly, from behind Ye Ye's office door, I heard a loud burst of words.
"Counter-revolutionary! Bourgeois! Revolutionist spy!"
I do not know what those words mean. All I hear is,
"Bad! Wrong! Liar! Traitor!"
My grandmother touches her hand to my forehead and realizes that those yelled insults have triggered a fever. I am scared of losing Ye Ye, and my heart is gripped by the feeling that something terrible is about to happen. It all happens in a fraction of a second.
"Don't be afraid,"
my grandfather says as he comes out of his office and walks, flanked by soldiers, toward the front door. That is his only concern at this moment, as he prepares to leave his home, his wife, the mother of his 7 children, as he prepares to leave his granddaughter, the only child of his youngest son, as he prepares to leave the Ai, who has served his family for 10 years,
that we not be afraid.
And most of all, that we do not insult him by awaiting his return before we eat dinner. He says all of this while the 7 or 8 tense jaws under caps mass around his tall and noble figure. We stayed outside the door for a long time, in shock. Not the front door. No, we stood outside the wide open door of his office for a long time before we dared go in. Something of him remained there in his office, and it was with that something that we tried to find consolation. Nai Nai went in first, and I followed her, refusing to let go of her hand. Then came our dear Ai. She had been living with us in Beijing for 10 years, having come from her native Hebei province to help my grandmother look after me. Her gentle face was more familiar to me than the face of my own mother. I thought I had seen every possible emotion on that face of hers, depending on whether I was docile, obedient, conscientious, lazy, careless, or bad-tempered. But never had I seen her cry before. On my grandfather's desk, there were pages from the People's Daily, the People's Liberation Army Daily, and the Red Flag, annotated in the margins in his handwriting.
"Lan, come and help me,"
he would say, gesturing with his chin at the inkstone, the rice paper, the calligraphy brush, the treasures of a Chinese man of letters. He watched my clumsy hand movements, guiding them until the ink came from the stone onto the lashes of the brush. He was as skilled at Chinese calligraphy as he was at writing with a fountain pen or even a ballpoint pen, which was the only way that we knew how to write. Everybody agreed that Ye Ye was an excellent calligrapher, and connoisseurs praised the quality of his poems in the ancient style. Ye Ye knew the classic texts, too, the stories of the ancient dynasties that were no longer taught in schools, the great learning, the doctrine of the mean, the Analects of Confucius, and the Mencius, the 4 books that all honest men were supposed to possess, the spidery handwriting that covered the newsletters and magazines that he read also demonstrated a perfect understanding of English. The only thing missing from his office was the large radio on which, every morning at 7:30, even on weekends, he would listen to the news. But that radio was not his. My father had lent it to him the previous year because my grandfather's radio had died. Nai Nai was right. I remember it all the more since, soon after that date, instead of telling me that my father was under house arrest in his office, they simply announced that because he was very busy at the moment, he would only be able to come and see me occasionally. Nai Nai, who was used to reading my thoughts and emotions in my face, must have guessed what was on my mind.
"Don't worry, Nan Nan," she said. "You'll see. By January or February, everything will be back to normal, and Mingfu will be with us again."
I noticed that she was loath to add the name of another beloved person, my grandfather, to this sentence, and I realized...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.